Good morning. My name is Jennifer. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. I am your worship associate today. Thank you for joining us. Together, we acknowledge that our church building stands on Native lands. Surrounding us are the landscapes of the Pueblo peoples who continue to maintain vital connections to this place. We honor the ancestral stewards of our property and celebrate their past, present, and future. Wherever we gather on ancestral ground. If you're online now and joining us for the first time, please introduce yourself in the chat if it comes back on.
There we go.
Because we love to know who's watching with us. And if you have a joy or a sorrow to share with our community and you are here in the room, please write your joy or sorrow in the book that's on the pedestal at the back of the room. If you're on our live stream, please write your joy and sorrow in an email and send it to joysandsorrows@uusantafe.org right now, and we will read it later in the service. Our opening words are by Penny Hackett Evans. Each of us brings a separate truth here.
We bring the trust of our own life, of our own story.
We don't come as empty vessels, but as full people, each with our own story and our own truth.
We seek to add to our truths and add to our stories. This room is rich with truth and ripe with experience.
All manner of people are here, needy, joyful, frightened, anxious, bored.
We all bring our truth with us.
May we all recognize the truth and the story in other lives than our own. May we hear and honor the truths that we all bring as we gather together.
Today, we have truths.
Together, we have a story.
Together, we have a community. May it be so.
And now please kindle your chalice at home as we kindle ours here. May this flame, symbol of transformation since time began, fire our curiosity, strengthen our wills, and sustain our courage as we seek what is good within and around us.
Since last summer, parents, school boards, and thirsty political groups have pulled off over 1,500 book bans in schools across the U.S. That's more bans than in 2018, 2019, and 2020 combined. But hey, at least we've moved past actually burning books.
Mom, let me throw some books.
Okay, maybe not. Moving on. Actual book bans have taken hold in districts in over half the states and hit more than 1,000 different titles. Some books have been removed in many districts. Others got targeted in only one. The titles range from books that only a few advanced readers might be interested in to picture books about making tamales at Christmas. But because sometimes people do think some books are too racy or, I guess, too spooky, the American Library Association has recommendations for how someone can submit a questionable book to be reviewed and possibly removed. This process usually involves the government's number one fetish, paperwork, which is supposed to make sure the people trying to pull books have, you know, read those books. But those protocols aren't being followed. Only 4% of reported bans since last summer followed a formal process. Most were handed down by school administrators or board members, often looking to appease screaming adults.
This is pornography, plain and simple, and it does not belong in our schools.
In one district in Pennsylvania, people complained about books and the board banned 441 titles, including a picture book about Supreme Court Justice Sonia Sotomayor and a book about Black women in STEM. And in Texas, a parent helped ban a book using pretty intimate confessions.
I do not want my children to learn about
in middle school. I've never had I don't want to have I don't want my kids to have
These bans aren't just a random attack on the threat of full bookshelves. Many of the banned books have main characters who are people of color. About a quarter directly address race or racism. A little more than that deal with themes related to being LGBTQ. Whenever there is a time of social progress, people tend to fight back by trying to control information. The Confederacy did that with Uncle Tom's Cabin. And more recently, in the 80s, Jerry Falwell and his evangelical masses went after a few of the classics because of what they called obscenity. But some of these new bans are backed up with new laws that can come with harsh penalties. 17 states now restrict teaching race in classrooms, especially in ways that make students feel discomfort, anguish, or guilt. Similar bans have been introduced in at least 25 other states. The Florida bill that limits talking about gender or sexuality in schools is being used as a model in at least a dozen other places. Teachers who don't follow some of these laws can lose their jobs. Schools that violate the discomfort law in Tennessee can have up to $5 million of funding withheld. Conservative politicians and advocacy groups are playing off that fear by releasing lists of hundreds of books that they think should be forbidden. So even if they're not formally banned, schools are taking these books off the shelves to avoid the fight. Like a district in Florida, where a conservative group released something called the 2021 Porn Report, which is not a breakdown of all the things you looked up on incognito mode. Instead, it's just a list of kids' books they found icky. It includes the book Everywhere Babies, which is about babies, but here's the twist, they're everywhere. There wasn't an explanation for why it was on a porn list, but the author said it's because of this picture. I will say, if you think two men putting their arms around each other is pornographic, do not watch men's team sports. It gets obscene. Americans don't agree on much, but almost all of them think books should not be banned. These edicts are coming because of the loudest groups of conservative parents and the politicians who have figured out they can get an advantage at the polls by riling those parents up.
We watched parents so upset because there was such sexually explicit material in the library.
Some calling for the immediate removal of this very graphic, pornographic material from our libraries and our schools.
Do you agree with this book that is being taught with kids that babies are racist?
It's hard to know if bans actually keep books out of kids' hands. A group in Texas has an underground library to caravan banned books to students who can't get them. And places like the Brooklyn Public Library are offering free memberships to U.S. teenagers anywhere, so they can access whatever books they want. And then there's the whole internet. But what is clear is that the people most impacted are already the students. Students who are being robbed of places and ways to ask questions and get information. Who are being told that something about themselves is wrong or pornographic, or that their lived experiences has never been and never will be part of the American story.
Wow. What are they afraid of? These folks who think children's books need to be pulled off the shelves. Because that's what it's about. It's about fear. Fear of change, fear of loss, fear that the system that they've supported with their lives might be wrong or might be in the wrong, fear of different worldviews, fear of different ideas. A recent article in Newsweek remarked that there's no documented evidence anywhere that access to books about class or gender or sexuality will turn one into a communist or make one queer or change one's sexual orientation. But I do suspect that reading books about people from different classes or with different gender identities or gender expression might help humanize people that you've never encountered. And I guess for some people, that might be frightening. As we heard in the clip, most of the folks who are challenging books in the US right now are conservative parents or conservative parent groups. It's increasingly backed by conservative political groups and conservative politicians. But historically, all kinds of groups who had power banned books, including governments and religious leaders. In fact, including some of our religious forebears. Our New England forebears, the Pilgrims, have the dubious honor of being the first to ban the first book on this continent. It had ideas they didn't like. According to an article in the Washington Post last January, quote, the prize for the first banned book in America probably goes to Thomas Morton's New English Canaan, which was written in 1634, 1637, there doesn't seem to be agreement on that, by a dissident who fled the Plymouth colony in what is now Massachusetts. Morton attacked the Pilgrims for their religious zealotry and their cruelty toward the Native Americans on the land that they settled, going so far as to claim that the devil was the setter of their church. Now, the New English Canaan is a three-volume work. The first volume collects Morton's observations about the Native American people who lived there, the Wampanoag. And he's very sympathetic and supportive of their full humanity, at least in the context of the time. The second volume of his book was a description of the ecosystems and natural beauty and resources of New England. And it's only the third one, which is the scathing satire of the Puritans and the Pilgrims. The consequence for the author was exile in Maine. Well, remember, this was back before that was part of the same alliance of colonies. This was like being sent to another country. In our own time, the consequences of writing books that others want to ban can be equally devastating. Witness the attack on Salman Rushdie at Chautauqua earlier this month, which has been all over the news. The long-standing fatwa on Rushdie and on all the publishers and translators of his book, The Satanic Verses, comes with a bounty of $3.3 million. Rushdie suffered serious damage to an eye, an arm, and to his liver. He was on a ventilator for quite a while, but I think has since been removed from the ventilator, and apparently his sense of humor is still intact. Apparently, the assailant read about 2 pages of Rushdie's book, deciding that it was too dangerous, and he's not been forthcoming about the role that the fatwa might have had in his actions, but was very clear that he understood that Rushdie was an enemy of Islam and the Ayatollah was a virtuous leader. Now, our First Amendment in this country protects citizens' freedom of speech and expression in almost all cases, but the right But children's access has always been more limited than the access that adults have. And so it's become far more common to challenge and limit access to books published for kids. Now, I believe that banning books is about fear and the desire to control the things you are afraid of. And where kids' books are concerned, parents are afraid not for themselves, but for their children. Book challengers are trying to protect their kids from content that they find objectionable. And many of us as parents can understand that. Unfortunately, the strategy is to prevent others from reading the books as well. That limits the freedom of other children and other families to have access to the books that they might want or need to have access to. Now, it's curious, I think, that first book banned in our nation's history was banned for some of the same reasons that books are challenged and removed from library shelves today. It's attitudes on race, on religion, and although it's not in the text itself, it's attitudes about sexuality. Because Morton was the founder of Marymount, which was a colony south of Plymouth, which was in full rebellion against the Pilgrim and Puritan mores. So, Kimmy and I wanted you not to be afraid to read banned books. We want our children not to be afraid to read banned books. And so we recorded ourselves reading some portion of children's books that have been banned recently and over the years. We're going to share that with you now. And as we get ready to do that, you might be interested in knowing that it is possible that the reason that our chat has been disabled today is because banned books are content that YouTube finds anxiety-provoking.
Good morning. I am Kimmy Floyd Reich. I am the Program Ministry Director here at UU Santa Fe. It is such a pleasure to be with you today. My pronouns are they, them, or she, her. Today, we are going to talk about banning books.
Over the years, many books have been banned. We'd like to read passages from a few children's books that have been challenged around the country and sometimes removed from schools and libraries.
To start, we'll consider Winnie the Pooh by A.A. Milne, which was published in 1926. It was banned in numerous states because talking animals are an insult to God.
From A.A. Milne, one day, when the sun had come back over the forest, bringing with it the scent of May, and all the streams of the forest were tinkling happy to find themselves in their own pretty shape again, and the little pools lay dreaming of the life they had seen and the big things they had done. And in the warmth and quiet of the forest, the cuckoo was trying over his voice carefully and listening to see if he liked it, and the wood pigeons were complaining gently to themselves in their lazy, comfortable way that it was the other fellow's fault. But it really didn't matter much on such a day as this. Now, on such a day as this, Christopher Robin whistled in his special way that he had. An owl came flying out of the 100-acre wood to see what was wanted. "Owl," said Christopher Robin, "I am going to give a party." Another book challenged frequently is The Diary of Anne Frank. It was first published in 1947, and recently the graphic novel has been banned. But over the years, it's been removed because of sexual themes and promoting homosexuality. But mostly, it's been banned because the adults find it too depressing.
Many challenged books are ones that were written from the perspective of people who are not white, not straight or cisgender, and often not Christian. Maurice Sendak's 1963 picture book, Where the Wild Things Are, was banned after publication in almost every southern state because it promoted witchcraft and supernatural events. Some books have historically been challenged because they represent a version of the world that once hurt people or does hurt people. 1964's Charlie and the Chocolate Factory was written by Roald Dahl, and it was challenged for decades because of the racism reflected in the depiction of the Oompa Loompas. The 1988 book was even edited to remove those problematic sections and images. However, it is much more common today to ban books because they reflect the stories that conflict with our political beliefs and positions. We are now going to read from three of the most recent banned picture books.
The first one is titled Julian is a Mermaid. It's by Jessica Love, and it's a story told almost entirely in pictures. It's about a little boy who wants to become a mermaid so that he can participate in the Coney Island Mermaid Parade. It's been pulled from dozens of libraries because of fears and beliefs regarding gender-expansive children. Here's a little part of the story, and we'll show you a few of the beautiful illustrations as well. This is a boy named Julian, and this is his abuela, and those are some mermaids. Julian loves mermaids.
Later in the story, Julian loves mermaids so much that he pulls down his grandmother's lace curtains to make himself a mermaid costume. When she comes back into the room, Julian expects her to be angry, but instead, this is what happens. Abuela holds out a necklace. For me, Abuela? For you, Julian. Where are we going? You'll see, says Abuela. Mermaids, whispers Julian. Like you, mijo. Let's join them. And they do.
Books are also targeted because they reflect stories that are mistakenly accused of promoting things like critical race theory, which is a college-level sociology concept. The 1619 Project, Born on the Water, by Nicole Hannah-Jones and Renee Watson, with illustrations by Nicholas Smith, was published in 2021, and it has already been challenged dozens of times. Here is a passage from the story, which is told from the perspective of a little girl who comes home and tells her grandmother that she felt ashamed at school that day. The teacher had assigned a project that traced their family histories back many generations so each student could determine where their ancestors came from and where they began. Like many people who were harmed by colonialism, the names of the little girl's ancestors and the places they came from have been lost. When she tells her grandmother what happened, this is the story her grandmother tells her. They say our people were born on the water, but our people had a home, a place, a land before they were sold. 400 years ago, our ancestors were taken and brought here on a ship called the White Lion, a whole year before the Mayflower arrived. The people were good with their minds, good at math and science. They used shells for money, counting, recording, trading. They had a language. They spoke Kimbuntu, and they had their own words for love, for friends, and for family. And then after they arrive in America, the grandmother continued, they said, we are in a strange land, but we are here and we will make a home. We have our songs, our recipes, our know-how. We have our joy. We will laugh, love, and sing. And we will hug our children as tight as you can hold a child. We will survive because we have each other. And hearing the story, the little girl went back to school the next day. She sat down, and this is her continuation of what happened. She pulled out her red crayon. She pulled out her blue crayon and her white crayon. And she drew the stars and she drew the stripes of the flag of the country that her ancestors built. And she said, of the country that my grandma and grandpa built, that I will help build too. And I am not ashamed. I know what my story is, where I am from, where I begin.
Finally, we want to share a book written by Ibram X. Kendi and illustrated by Ashley Lukashevsky that was not just banned, but some of the pages were enlarged and shared by a senator challenging the nomination of the first Black female Supreme Court justice. It's called Anti-Racist Baby, and it was published in 2020.
Anti-racist baby is bred, not born. Anti-racist baby is raised to make society transform. Babies are taught to be racist or anti-racist. There's no neutrality. Here are some of the steps to make equity a reality.
Open your eyes to all skin colors. Use your words to talk about race.
Point at policies as the problem, not people. And shout, there's nothing wrong with the people.
Celebrate all of our differences. Believe that we can overcome racism. And don't judge a book by its cover, but read it clear through to the end.
So we set a time, we set aside a time each Sunday to kindle our peace candle and to ask for peace in our hearts, peace in our nation, peace in our world, peace in Ukraine. And we move from that sense of peace into a time of joys and of sorrows, knowing that when we share joys, they burn more brightly. And when we share our sorrows, they are easier to bear. I have a sorrow to begin with. It is with great sorrow that I share the news of the death of my father-in-law this past weekend. Ken Marriner was 92 years old and will be deeply missed. And then we have a joy from Jennifer. I have a great joy these last few weeks at Reunity Resources doing weeding and working the farm stand. So much summer bounty and beautiful vegetables and a long continuing harvest. Gwen Pinkham sends information for two candles. First, a candle of concern. My sister is no longer in remission for her multiple myeloma, and it has become resistant to chemotherapy. They will be starting something newer fairly soon. And a joy? Two human-caused fires on the mountain that meets up with my backyard last Saturday. Both are out again with minimal harm. Another somewhat larger fire started by lightning Friday was mostly contained by yesterday evening, as best I understand, though they did have some cautions about cautions lingering about wind. And visitors today. Okay, I'm going to use my best handwriting decoding glasses here. Alan Murray from Sedona, and maybe Melissa? And Melissa Murray, also from Sedona. Welcome to you both. Stan and Jackie Darnell, Unitarian Universalists from Allen, Texas. Welcome, we're glad you're here. Brenda Dutro from Colorado, welcome. Ashley Trotter from Gladstone, Mississippi, Michigan, I'm sorry. And Vivian Valle from El Paso, Texas. Yay, way in the back. Welcome. We're glad that you are here. Friends, we encourage you to greet our visitors on the portal after the service while you have a cup of coffee or are signing some letters for one of our various campaigns. Now, holding these sorrows and joys in our hearts, let us sing. Let us light one more candle for those we have not yet shared, and then sing or hum Spirit of Life. Resting on the echoes of the music, Let us move into a time of quiet and contemplation. I invite you to close your eyes, friends, if that is comfortable for you, to settle yourself in your chair, to take a deep breath, and as you exhale, to let your body relax. As you settle into the quiet, let your thoughts drift. As your body begins to relax, feel your heart begin to soften and open. Breathe. And let it expand until it can cradle all of the sorrows and the joys, all the tensions and the conundrums that are a part of being human in this time. Breathe, friends. And as we rest in this moment together, feel yourself connected and held in the affectionate regard of this community, and know that you are not alone. Breathe. Breathe. You may have heard the saying that when an old person dies, a library burns. You are a library. You are a treasure trove of stories surrounded in this time and space by other treasure troves containing history and fables, anecdotes and fairy tales, heroic adventures and mundane stories. You are a library of family narratives and big political events. And if you don't share your stories, if we don't share our stories and the stories of our loved ones and our families and our lives together in community and apart out in the wide, wide world, then we and our loved ones and our values and our vision of the world will fade from the larger memory. And other people will decide what our lives mean. Take a moment as we rest in the quiet and feel the stories that dwell in you. Who needs to hear your stories, friend? And how will you tell them? Will you sit with a grandchild? Will you paint a beautiful painting? Will you write your stories into poetry or song? Our stories make and keep us human. Our stories are part of the great ongoing collection of truths. Each of you is a library, my friends, filled with unique and precious stories. Please share your stories with the people in your world.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lydia. Our reading this morning is from the book Read Dangerously by Azar Nafisi. When it comes to freedom, writers and readers are joined at the hip, for the freedom of one guarantees that of the other. Writing, of course, may have repercussions for writers, placing them in danger. But books can also be dangerous for readers, because great works of fiction are about revealing the truth. Great writers, in this sense, become witnesses to the truth. They do not, cannot remain silent. But readers as well, once they read the work, cannot remain silent. This is true, especially now. Readers number in the billions. They range across the spectrums of profession, background, gender, race, ethnicity, religious affiliation. Every writer who is censored, jailed, or tortured and murdered, every reader who is deprived of reading the books she wants, every bookstore, library, museum, or theater that closes, every book that is censored or removed from schools and libraries, every art, music, or literature program canceled in our schools or other institutions. These should remind us all of our responsibility. My dear fellow reader, in a world made opaque by wars and conflict, one in which our enemies may dominate our hearts and minds more than our friends do, where lies masquerade as truth, we need the clear eye of imagination to see the reality behind and beyond the show.
Thank you. Despite the restrictive practices of our Puritan and Pilgrim forebears, our fourth Unitarian Universalist principle, the promise to affirm and promote the free and responsible search for truth and meaning, puts our faith in alignment with First Amendment protections and freedom of speech, and echoes the American Library Association's support of intellectual freedom, and calls us as Unitarian Universalists into action here and now to help exercise and protect the right to read, and the right to write, and the right to publish. Although book bans are nothing new, there were more censorship attempts in 21 and 2022 than at any time since the American Library Association began tracking more than two decades ago. And the consequences of dissent have become more stringent. They are impacting the lives and livelihoods of teachers and librarians who risk lawsuits and job loss for protecting our freedom to read. And here's the challenge for those of us who are in support of freedom to read. Freedom of speech protects the rights of would-be censors and book challengers to challenge access to reading materials and to try to persuade school boards and library boards and others to remove books from the shelves, just as it protects the rights of people who support intellectual freedom to challenge that censorship and make their case to those same library boards, school boards, and others in power. The recent problem appears to be that the people who want to ban the books and limit the freedom to write and read have been more intentional and more organized than those of us who support intellectual freedom. And they have frequently done an end run around the stated processes that are made available. And it's those end runs that are part of what is causing the problem. Now, to be fair, liberals have been known to challenge books, albeit for different reasons than our more conservative colleagues. But the issue here is that there need to be, at least for me, one of the issues here is I don't necessarily think it's appropriate for us to ban books we don't like. And there are plenty of conservative books out there representing restrictive sexual ideas about sexuality and gender and race that I wouldn't choose to read or to share with you, but that I think people ought to have access to if that's the worldview they're trying to explore. And I don't think banning those books is appropriate. So there needs to be something more than tit for tat. If you banned the books I support, I'm going to ban the books you like. Just doesn't seem like the way to move forward on this. The American Library Association, again, a shout out for librarians. The American Library Association is a great resource when it comes to thinking about challenged and banned books and intellectual freedom. They actually have an office of intellectual freedom. I think I need to go visit. It's just, yeah, how cool is that? And they're in charge of a national campaign right now called Unite Against Banned Books, which is a campaign to protect people's rights to access the books and other resources that they want and need in libraries and schools and elsewhere. Banned Books Week is coming up this next month. And I encourage you to go online and to find Banned Books Week on the ALA site and to get yourself some I Read Banned Books swag. The theme this year is Censorship Divides Us and Reading Unites Us. The key talking point, I think, for the ALA, for the Banned Books campaigns, we trust individuals to make their own decisions about what they read and what they believe. Join us as we unite against book bans. I love that sentence. We trust individuals to make their own decisions about what they read and believe. Unitarian Universalists have been doing that for generations. We trust individuals to make their own decisions about which sources they turn to for religious inspiration, about which ideas they ultimately hold in their hearts. People who are admirers of Salman Rushdie gathered on Friday on the steps of the public library and read excerpts of his work out loud in support of the freedom to read. You saw in the brief news clip that we showed this morning that the Brooklyn Library has made library cards available to young people across the nation so that they may access any book they desire or need to explore. And youth and sometimes young adults are forming book clubs across the country specifically devoted to exploring the books the adults have banned. We can help. We can help by tracking with our schools and libraries to make sure that books are not being banned, by expressing support for our library professionals, by attending library and school board meetings, and by being ready to turn out in defense of the right to read if we do arrive at that point where someone is trying to limit that freedom. We can also help with letters to the editor, supporting intellectual freedom, and the need to be able to read widely so that we and our neighbors can form informed opinions and make wise decisions in our lives and when we vote. And what about reading books that we feel are harmful and making those harmful books available to others? Well, other than immediately ordering and reading our own copies of contested texts, the strategies that seem to work are some of those that were used with the older, more problematic Newbery Award-winning books we talked about several weeks ago. We need to read critically, taking the time and the context of the book into consideration. We need to actually take the author's social location and the nature of the book into account as we look at how it's presented. We need to read not just one text, but to consider many versions of the same story told from different points of view. We need to consciously decolonize our bookshelves by looking for the missing and marginalized points of view, finding them and holding them up, reading them. We need to be curious. That's easy in this room. And outspoken. Our stories are precious. And the right to read widely and the right to write and share our stories is a freedom essential to a functioning democracy. And we need to help nurture and protect it. I want to close with a quote from Salman Rushdie, who wrote, "A book is a version of the world. If you don't like it, ignore it, or offer your own vision, your own version in return." May it be so. And you are invited to join me, and I think Kimmy is going to join me too, and anyone else who would like to, right here in the front of the chancel, and we're going to talk a little bit about This Is the Canon, about Read Dangerously, and about any of the other banned books you might have brought with you to debate or explore. Okay.
Earrings and masks. And glasses. And microphones.
Yeah. They all don't work together. All right. Thank you so much. We're just so blessed by the generosity of so many of you, you who are here with us today and those who've come before us, our ancestors, and we share the gifts we've been given as an expression of our gratitude. So we'd also ask you to please sign on to the environmental justice letters available in the courtyard and drop into the library after the service to help our letter writers get out the vote effort. So thanks so much. Our closing words are by Sarah York. We receive fragments of holiness, glimpses of eternity, brief moments of insight. Let us gather them up for the precious gifts that they are, and renewed by their grace, move boldly into the unknown. And now our chalice is extinguished, but its light lives on in the minds and the hearts and the souls of each one of us. Let us carry the flame with us and share it with those we know, with those we love, and most especially with those we have yet to meet.
If you would take hands with someone sitting near you, if that feels comfortable. And if you would repeat after me. May love and skill be in our hands. May love and courage fill our hearts. May love and wisdom light our minds. May love flow through us and walk among us. As we live our lives and work to heal our world. Amen, shalom, namaste, blessed be. Assalamu alaikum, ashe, aho. Thank you, friends. Would you please stay seated for the postlude? Joining us today, friends. We hope that you enjoyed today's service. Please take a little time and explore our website and visit our online welcome table if you'd like to know more about us. Otherwise, we'll see you next Sunday morning. Stay in touch and be well.